Beef is fantastic. Lamb's great. Like a lamb. I know you got your eye on pork today, haven't you?
There's a loin there.
Yeah.
That lovely loin, look.
What yeah. should people be looking for when... Because my dad was a pork producer. He was a pork farmer. And he always said to me, he said, pork should be bred to sit in a field and eat. and not bred to be sort of Linford Christie and jump the 100-metre hurdles.
Don't be scared of when you buy pork, have plenty of fat.
It needs a decent amount
you
of fat.
You need the fat. It renders into the meat and it keeps it moist. That's where they go wrong.
All right, so I'm going to leave you to that. Yeah. Meanwhile, I'm going to find some dessert that I can use.
Oui. Yorkshire portions. Do you hear that? Yorkshire portions from Martin. Fantastic. He's just cut four nice steaks of that pork. Well, I've got an idea with some pumpkin later on that I'm going to show you.
One thing that I've spotted here while he's wandering off buying the old pork is quince. It's beautiful with pork, but also here he is. When it's cooked, this stuff is fantastic, isn't it? I thought I'd cook this down, peel it.
Yeah.
You can never peel it with a normal peeler. You have to peel it conventionally with a knife.
It's like a cricket ball.
It is. Rock out. It's crossed between a pear and an apple, and stew it down and serve that with sliced apples on the top. So like a classic French apple tart. Oh, and the great flavours with quince is this stuff, honey. Beautiful, beautiful honey. It goes complements quince so well. So what I thought I'd do, instead of making an ice cream, is just literally mix together a touch of creme fraiche with a little bit of honey. Is it our creme fraiche, see what we play? No, you need it really, really extra thick creme fraiche. You just gradually fold the honey through it.
Got a fan, mate, it's your fan. Your fan here.
At least I've got a fan. The Lawrence looks very at home here.
What have they all got in common? Colour of the hair.
That's it, loaded up and ready to cook. But first, how to prepare tomato concasse, the quick and easy Martin way.
Now, you constantly get chefs telling you about tomato concasse. The easiest way to do a tomato concasse is to use boiling water, remove the central part of the tomato like that, and then this is the classic way, lift that out, is to make a little cross in there and then boil it in boiling salted water for literally for about sort of 10 seconds, take it out, blanch it into ice cold water, and then the skin peels off. If you haven't time to do that, literally take the tomato like that. These larger ones cut into sort of three or four. The idea of a tomato concasse is to eat the flesh of the tomato, but without the skin and the seeds. So you're just gonna remove the seeds. You can of course use those for sauces, soups, stocks and bits and pieces, but just cut underneath, put the knife flat onto the board, just press the knife flat. The skin should just easily come off. Now, often you can use these tomatoes like these. These are lovely, sprinkled with a bit of thyme, bit of garlic, olive oil, cooked in the oven, just confit slowly for about 10 minutes. Alternatively, we can slice the tomatoes like that to create the concasse and then cut through and dice up. And that way you can use them for a variety of different French dishes, from sauces, garnish, to one of my favorite, which is a little Vierge sauce, which is made with olive oil, tomatoes, and fresh herbs with a good squeeze of lemon juice. And there you have it. Just a simple tomato concasse. Okay, the sun's out and pork's on the menu. So what are we cooking then? This loin of pork that we got.
Nice pork steaks. Lovely. We're gonna go with the squash, diced squash, a little bit of star anise. Chop all that down, sweat it down with the star anise and garlic, olive oil.
Okay.
Finish with a bit of chervil. And you're gonna do something interesting with the celery leaves that you
want to
do.
Deep fry them, like tempura sort of things, but just a simple little batter.
I'm all ears, you wanna do it?
Deep fry them, don't worry about that. Right, okay. Which one do you want?
This is the big one.
You take the big daddy. The problem with these is the peeling of it that takes the time, isn't it?
Yeah.
But other things, I mean, loads of countries do sort of squashes and pumpkins and stuff like that. I mean, one of the great recipes that I learned was the ravioli with the old pumpkin on squashes.
Yeah.
But you put, let's just put your amaretti biscuits in there.
That's right, yeah.
Into the puree. Tastes really good.
That'd be enough for now, yeah?
Yeah. Pan on.
Pan on. Olive oil.
Okay. Lovely, decent amount of olive oil. You want the whole lot in there now?
Yes, please.
Okay. Squashes and stuff like that are great in desserts as well.
Yeah.
They make the most amazing ice cream.
Yeah, beautiful.
Just take the puree, and all you need to do is cook it like this, even in a bit of oil, a bit of butter, blend it together with a paste, and it's also great. That paste is then good to fold into risottos, which is really good, about sort of 8 minutes into the cooking process. Alternatively, you can mix it with a little bit of ice cream.
If you want to season them pork steaks up, give them a really good salt and pepper. In there, that's that.
Well seasoned.
Yeah, really good, lots of salt and pepper.
Okay, you're gonna throw the garlic in?
Like later on.
Okay, what about the anise?
The anise can go in now. We'll put in about, okay. There's my spoon.
Now this is star anise that we're using. You can actually buy the star anise. It's quite difficult to get ground star anise, but all you do is put it in a coffee grinder and just grind it down. But it's quite strong, isn't it?
It's about a teaspoon and a bit. It's about a teaspoon to start off with. Let's just get it cooking in there to start with. Is there any salt
and
pepper?
Two teaspoons got in there. Yeah.
Is there any salt and pepper in there?
No, not in there. Do you want some? Bit of salt and pepper. Yeah. And how long do you cook this for now? The smell of that.
It won't take long. It's just literally want them to just start giving and we take the pan straight off.
Right. Okay, I've got a hot pan here for the pork.
Yeah.
Bit of oil.
You whack it and I'll come around behind you.
There you go.
Ready? Our nice pork steaks.
I suppose if you didn't have any star anise, a bit of sage maybe to go with this. You could. Yeah, you people could didn't sage. Like that sort of aniseedy sort of flavour.
They don't like it, some sage in there.
Yeah.
You know? Or like you said, what's wrong with a bit of crushed amaretti biscuits?
Yeah, something like that.
Do it the same. Do it the same. It's no big deal, is it? I think we've put a touch of garlic in there now. I'm putting quite a bit, because we like our garlic, don't we? When we're in France.
Three cloves of garlic in there.
And then we've put a splash of white wine in the pumpkin. Just let it stew gently. Cool.
There you go. Smells superb, doesn't it?
The garlic and anise, yeah. Very simple dish, but very effective once this is finished.
Well, I'll take that off to one side. Nice and soft.
Some good aromas coming off of there, isn't
it? Lovely. And I'm going to get my pan on here, because you want these little fritters, don't you, these next?
Yeah.
Oh. So I'll grab some veg oil for this.
You got this nice celery, didn't you?
Yeah, this celeriac. Now, I love celery. I just think one of the dishes that I spoke about was remoulade, which is actually, in essence, really, really simple. Just a little bit of mayonnaise. Mm. I used to put a bit of Dijon mustard, or you can put a bit of grain mustard through it as well. Bit of chopped dill, bit of chopped parsley, chopped chives, something like that. Mix it all together, and it's like the French equivalent to sort of coleslaw.
Coleslaw,
simply make a batter. All I'm going to use, really, is a bit of flour, a bit of salt, a bit of milk. And there it is. Just mix it together so it's like a soft batter.
I'm going to take that off the stove. That's ready. I'll let it cool down.
There you go. And the batter here, you can see it's actually quite soft.
Should you put the chives in there?
I didn't put a few chives, yeah. In fact, no, I'll probably put a little bit of this, actually.
Yeah.
The chervil, because I love chervil. Mm-hmm. If you've got a garden at home, grow it, because it is just magic stuff. Just going to roughly throw that in as well. And then just test this, make sure my oil's nice and hot. Just with a little spoonful of this batter.
Right.
That should be about there, actually. Nice and hot. Quite a hot oil, because we want them to literally just sit in there and straight up, nice and quickly. So I'm going to put the leaves in.
I better be quick then.
Literally just throw these in, because these are in there for about sort of 10 seconds max.
I've just chopped that chervil down. Fold it into that pumpkin mixture.
Yeah. These are just about there. Coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Nice and crisp. And we're doing it with the deep fried tops, but I suppose for a dinner party, you could just do that. And the pork, couldn't you really? Yeah, just leave it at that. Maybe just a little bit of roast pork, maybe.
There's a pork.
Pork on the top.
Mm. Fantastic.
Nice like that.
Let's get some of these
less is more, chef. We don't want it to look like a harvest festival. Yeah. A little bit of oil around the edge.
That's lovely.
Look at that, cooked in a field. Brilliant. I've been looking forward to tasting this because it smells just delicious.
It's lovely, isn't it? Taste that pumpkin. Just very in the background, isn't it?
It's the first time I'm going to say nothing. Absolutely nothing.